Exacto.
Today's topic is deaf child and newborn hearing screening and rehabilitation. Usually a child with profound loss, that is more than 90 dB hearing loss, they are termed as deaf mute or hard of hearing, and they fail to develop normal speech and language. So as we all know, birth to 5 years of age is very much critical for speech and language development. So early identification and assessment of the hearing loss and rehabilitation of these children is very much essential before 6 months for near normal speech and language development. So usually for early identification, nowadays newborn hearing screening is widely used. Presently, it's universally applied to all the newborns that are restricted to high-risk population in NICU. The risk factors for permanent hearing loss in neonates are those infants or neonates who undergo treatment in NICU for more than 48 hours, and those who have the history of early childhood deafness. Oral craniofacial anomalies. That is those children with the flippant palate or other morphological abnormalities of the pinna and ear canal, or else few of them with in utero infections like Todd's complex, and those who have low birth weight, that is below 1500 grams of birth weight, or else those who have history of usage of ototoxic medication for epilepsy or other medical complications, or those with hyperbilirubinemia, that is neonatal jaundice. Usually the widely used hearing screening procedures are divided into behavioral screening procedures or instrumental or objective screening procedures. Under behavioral observation screening procedures, the first one is behavioral observation audiometry. This was first proposed by Wedenberg and Huffman in 1985, and the behavioral observation audiometry is most sensitive when the baby is active, that is, he is in awake position. Usually there are few reflexes which are observed when child is awake. First one of them is oropalpebral reflex, that is an eye blink, widening or closing of the eyes or orienting of the eyes towards the sound source. Second is glabellar reflex, or it's also called as cochleopalpebral reflex, that is an eye blink in response to loud sound which is above 90 or 80 dB. And next one is motor reflex, that is sudden movement of the limbs and the extension of the head. The other reflex is cessation reflex, that is stopping of the activity, which usually is seen in response to sound in free field of 80 or 90 dB. The behavioral observation audiometry is usually done by an audiologist in a noise treated room using a free field sound production of 80 or 90 dB through a loudspeaker. Sound is produced through a loudspeaker. And before the objective tests or objective screening procedures were there, usually child was assessed for his hearing using few of instruments like pressure transducers or plethysmography. That is when the child is in arousal state, that is when the child is awake, the autonomic measures are more sensitive after child 6 months of age. That is when child exceeds 6 months of age, the respiration rate, that is it increases or decreases, or they hold air in short gaps to the stimuli. And these changes in the respiration were measured using pressure transducers or plethysmography. Or else the heart rate on production of sound was recorded on an electrocardiogram, and the variation in the heart rate, that is increase or decrease, was noted on it. Next is identification audiometry. In this, a high amplitude sucking rate of infants, that is their changes in the sucking rate at even low stimulus intensities, were recorded using pressure transducer or with a feeding nipple. And initially, before the OAE screening procedures or BERA came into role, cribogram was used, and the cribogram was given by Simmons and Russ in 1974. In cribogram, pressure transducers were placed under the mattress or of the cot, and a microprocessor was placed, and the stimulus stopped if the baby is restless. And they produce a sound stimulus, and if the baby becomes restless, the sound was stopped, and the movements were automatically processed by the pressure transducers. And the stimuli in the cribogram was narrow point noise at 3 kHz frequency at 92 decibels intensity level for 3.5 seconds, which was given by a free fill loudspeaker. And after cribogram was auditory response cradle, which was given by Bennett in 1975. These were all the instruments which were given, which were used before the recent technology, that is OAEs screeners or BERA screeners. Before the advent of OAE and BERA screeners, these were the objective things which were used, which are cribogram and auditory cradle response. Auditory cradle response was given in 1975. Even in this, a pressure transducer and a microprocessor were placed in the cradle, and the stimulus was bandpass noise of at 2.5 kHz to 4.5 kHz, which was given for 5 seconds at 85 decibels intensity via earphones. And the previous thing, that is in the cribogram, the stimulus was given through loudspeaker, whereas in the auditory cradle response, the stimulus was given through earphones. And four responses were detected in the auditory response cradle, and these were detected using a transducer which was placed on the head, which was a rotating headset. The transducer was placed in the rotating headset, and the startle response and the body movements were noted by the pressure transducers at head rest and the mattress. Respiratory rate was measured with a transducer in band around the abdomen, and control and sound trails were given. And the recent update of objective test for hearing screening came with autoacoustic emissions ABR, that is auditory brainstem response. Nowadays it has been updated to auditory steady state response. So autoacoustic emissions are of two types: OAE evoked autoacoustic emissions or distortion product autoacoustic emissions. And OAEs and ABR are usually considered as a golden standard by many audiologists and other healthcare professions nowadays as for hearing screening, because they give 90 to 100% accurate results in hearing screening. Usually the newborn hearing screening procedures includes ABR and transient evoked or distortion product OAEs, and it is compulsory and must for all the NICU babies. Universally, this is a standard protocol. And if OAEs are absent in a well baby, then we further recommend them for auditory brainstem response. Usually, the OAEs are of two types. The evoked response OAEs are of two types. They are transient evoked OAEs and distortion product OAEs. So, as you all know, transient evoked OAEs are a series of click stimuli which are given at 80 to 85 dB intensity, and the responses are recorded. And these reflect the activity of outer hair cells of the cochlea and are usually absent when the hearing loss exceeds 30 decibels. The other one is distortion product OAS. In distortion product OAS, two tones are presented simultaneously to the cochlea to produce the distortion products. And these are used to test hearing in the range of 1000 to 8000 Hz and are absent when the hearing loss exceeds 50 decibels. So these are the two types of OAS which are usually used for newborn hearing screening. And this is a flowchart of the OAE protocol which is usually preferred. An OAE is performed in the NICU babies immediately, even in NICU and normal babies, immediately after birth within 24 to 48 hours. And if we get the result as pass, then it indicates normal hearing. And if we get it as refer, then we conduct the OAE screening after 1 week for the second time. Even if for the second time we get it as refer, then we refer them to the mid-year consultation to the ENTs. And after the ENT clearance, we do rescreening of the OAEs. And in the rescreen, if we get it as pass, then we consider them babies to be having near normal hearing. And even after the ENT clearance, if they get it as refer, then they are the population who have to be targeted for further testing. That is, they will be referred for further testing, that is auditory brainstem testing to the audiologist to assess the quantity of the hearing loss and for further rehabilitation. So after OAEs, the second procedure which is usually used is screening ABR or BERA. In screening ABR or BERA, the stimuli used is clipped at 1 or 2 intensities, commonly at 35 dB NHL. Usually the ABR misses the children with mild hearing loss. So some of the protocols of ABR use 75 dB intensity for the testing, and if they fail 70 dB and 75 dB intensity sound, if the child fails the screening at 35 dB. So the test protocol provides the results in the screening BERA as pass or fail, but it does not give the quantity of hearing loss. So further quantitative evaluation, that is detailed BERA or ASSR assessment, is a must. So as shown in the picture, in BERA screening we get the results in the form of waves. So in wave 1 we get the response from the auditory nerve, and in wave 2 we get the responses from cochlear nuclei, and wave 3 is from superior auditory complex, and wave 4 is for lateral meniscus, wave 5 is for inferior calculus, wave 6 is from medial genitalia body, and wave 7 is from lumbocortical tract. And these are few strengths and limitations of the ABR. It can be used immediately at or after birth, and the test it tests each individually and carefully. ENT. Usha. Usha. It tests each ear individually and frequency specific test, and it's rapid and non-invasive. It evaluates neural status of artery nerve and eighth nerve lesions. It's not sensitive to the central nervous system disorders, that is, which are above the brainstem, and it may also miss small artery nerve tumors, and it is also subjective to the interpretation of the audiologist. That is, the waves have to be interpreted by the audiologist. So it depends on the interpretation of the waves. The results depend on the interpretation of the waves. So absent ABR alone does not, it's not an index of hearing loss. In a few of premature babies, there may also be neuromaturational delay, and in few of the conditions like Autry neuropathy or Autry processing disorders, also we might get an absent AVR, but there is no hearing sensitivity which is affected in such cases. Even in case of fourth ventricular hydrocephalus or vascular abnormalities, they all can affect the AVR results. That is, in all these conditions, AVR may be absent, but still the hearing might be preserved. So usually the thing is that the AVR results must be correlated with other test results. Next, coming to the rehabilitation or the management of hearing impaired children. First thing is parental counseling. That is, the parents have to be properly counseled regarding the amplification and further rehabilitation of the children, the need for the amplification or further rehabilitation. And after that, in oral rehabilitation, we have hearing aids. That is, the child can go for hearing aid or cochlear implant, and also they might need assistive devices when they go to the school level. So, in hearing aids, we have conventional hearing aids, we have cross-routing of signal hearing aids, we have BAHA, that is bone-anchored hearing aids, and implantable hearing aids. I'll speak in detail about them in the later slides. Next, the main aim of the rehabilitation is to develop normal speech and language, and to make the child adjusted in the society, and also for occasional guidance. And consideration for the fitting of hearing aid are the degree of hearing loss, that is what type of hearing loss, the configuration of hearing loss and the type of hearing loss, and presence of recruitment or other things, and uncomfortable loudness level, the age of the child, and the mobility of the child, and other comorbid conditions may also affect the selection of hearing aid, and the cosmetic acceptance of the aid by the family members, type of the mold, and the type of the fitting. It can be binaural, monaural, or cross-routing of signals. So, hearing aid. Hearing aid basically consists of three parts, that is a microphone, amplifier, and a receiver. So, the sounds which are coming from the environment are picked up by the microphone, and then it's transmitted to the amplifier, which amplifies the sounds which are reaching to the ear, and then it's transmitted to the receiver. Through the receiver, the amplified sound which is received by the child enables the child to make maximum use of his residual hearing. And coming to the next part are the types of the hearing aids. Hearing aids may be of two types, sorry, not two types, they are of many types. Under ear conduction hearing aids, we have body level hearing aids, behind the ear hearing aids, receiver in the hearing aids, completely in the canal hearing aids. Okay, so in ear conduction hearing aids, basically they use an ear conduction pathway. That is, the sound travels through the outer ear, that is from the ear canal to the pinna, and its amplified sound is delivered to the tympanic membrane. That is, it uses hold the auditory pathway. The ear conduction hearing aid usually uses hold the auditory pathway. And previously, in 1960s, the most preferred were the body level hearing aids. Usually, the body level hearing aids are not preferred nowadays, but in 1960s, these are the hearing aids which were mostly preferred, which were worn in the shirt pocket, and they had a special harness which is clipped to the clothing, and the wire cords from the machine travel into the ear. That is, they are transmitted through the cords to the ear. And the next are the ear level hearing aids, which are the updated one. And the updated ear level hearing aids are of many types. That is, behind the ear hearing aid, which are coupled to the ear with the tubing and a mold. which are usually placed behind the ear. As you can see in the picture, these are the behind the ear hearing aids. Okay, and even in this, based on the size, we have many types like mini VTs and receiver in the canal. This is the receiver in the canal hearing aid, which is usually preferred in sloping hearing loss patients. And these are the behind the ear hearing aids. This is mini VT and this is normal custom VT. And after behind the ear hearing aid, we have in the ear hearing aid. This is an image of in the ear hearing aid. Usually the receiver, the amplifier and all the things are in the ear canal. Next is in the canal hearing aid. This is the in the canal hearing aid. And the next updated one is completely in the canal or invisible in the canal hearing aid. This is a completely in the canal hearing aid, and this is invisible in the canal hearing aid, that is IIC. The next type are the CROs, that is contralateral routing of the signals. Usually in cases with unilateral profound hearing loss, when one ear is completely dead, that is there is no residual left in one ear and the other ear is completely normal, in such cases to give bilateral amplification, that is to go for proper localization, CROs are preferred. Usually there is a microphone fitted on the side of the deaf ear and the receiver and the amplifier are on the better ear. So whatever sound comes from the poorer ear, comes from the side of the poorer ear, is picked up by the microphone and it's transmitted to the receiver and the amplifier, which is on the side of the better ear, and then so there's a proper amplification and it helps in sound localization by the deaf ear. Nowadays Bahas are replaced by the CROs. And next is bone conduction hearing aid.
Sorry, it's neuro ENT department.
On your list. ENT or audiologist. Audiologist and SLP. Next is bone conduction hearing aid. In bone conduction hearing aid, the amplified signal is transmitted via the bone vibrator, which is held on the headband or which is held even at the eyeglasses frame, and it's placed on the mastoid process. Sound reaches the inner ear directly, bypassing the outer ear in bone conduction hearing aid. It's usually indicated for people with conductive hearing loss, that is even in congenital abnormalities of the ear like atresia or all the other things, we can go for bone conduction hearing aids. And the updated model is bone conduction hearing aids is bone anchored hearing aids, which are implantable hearing aids, and the parts of the hearing aids are implanted surgically in Baha. Candidacy is in candidacy for Baha is like it's contradicted in patients with diabetes or active discharge of the ear, and it is usually preferable in children with congenital stapes fixation or malformation of the external ear like microtia or atresia. And even in children with advanced otosclerosis, where we get mixed hearing loss, even for them, Baha is a preferred amplification device, and even in unilateral deafness. So this is the gross picture of Baha. These are all the components of Baha, that is a microphone, and this is the battery component. This is visible outwards, and this is the thing which is which will be implanted, that is the crosser which will be implanted into the cochlea. So next is implantable mid-ear devices. These work on direct drive principles, that is the vibrations are delivered directly to the ossicular chain, leaving the ear canal open. And implantable mid-ear devices are of two types, piezoelectric devices, that is mid-ear transducers called as otologic device, and totally integrated cochlear amplifiers. Next is electromagnetic hearing devices. These are examples of these are Vibrant Sound Bridge by Medel. The other most preferred habilitation instrument for children, that is for infants, is a cochlear implant. That is, if hearing loss is identified before 6 months of age, the preferred thing is cochlear implant for development of near normal speech and language skills. And the principle of the cochlear implant is, although the health cells of the cochlea are damaged, the electrical stimulation of the auditory nerve, that is the eighth nerve in humans, could result in the perception of sound. Cochlear implant was first invented by William House, who performed his first implantation in 1961 using a single electrode device. So these are the components of cochlear implant. The external components are the speech processor and the transmitter, and speech processor is body worn behind the ear. The internal components are the surgical implanted receiver of the stimulator with an electrode array, as you can see here. And currently implants have multiple channel processors with electrodes having a row of contacts to deliver current to different places on the baseline membrane. So the candidacy for cochlear implantation is, they should have bilateral severe to profound hearing loss, and it can be used both in children or adults who are pre or postlingually deaf. There is no for the children who have little or no benefit from a hearing aid, and there are no medical contradictions for surgery. There are no medical contradictions for surgery in children, and they should have adequate cognitive ability to use the device. Commonly used cochlear implants are Nucleus Spectra, Nucleus 24, and the speech processor are eSpirit and Spirit, Medel implant with 8 electrodes, or Clarion, that is of 8, advanced by Bionics with 8 electrodes. And the next is auditory brainstem implant. It directly stimulates the cochlear nuclear complex in the brainstem by placing the implant in the lateral vessel of the fourth ventricle. In candidates with vestibular schwannoma, that is, if an infant has a vestibular schwannoma, then the auditory nerve has been completely served in the surgery. In such children, auditory brainstem implant may be advised. And after, even after all of these habilitation procedures, when the child goes to school level, they might need few assistive devices for better overall communication and better outcomes. So there are many assistive devices available. So assistive devices are non-HD devices to improve the communication in special difficult situation. They transmit the amplified sound directly from the source to the listener by transforming it into a visual or tactile signal. They are an addition to a hearing aid in the background noise in auditoriums, and they are used to alert the hearing impaired of the danger signals in the presence of environmental sounds. Based on the technology, they are divided into hardwired or induction loop systems, or amplified or frequency modulated systems, or infrared systems. And alerting devices also come under assistive devices. Alerting devices are those which produce extra loud sound signal. Like example of the alerting devices, hearing dog device. And the sounds are changed into light signals or vibrations. That is, when there is a phone ring or when there is a doorbell, the sound is changed into light signal or vibrations to give an alerting signal to the hearing impaired individual. And there are also few telecommunication devices which are considered as assistive listening devices. And the telecommunication devices for the deaf converts the typed messages into sounds that can be transmitted over the telephone. That is, whenever the a communicator gives a typed message, it's converted. Whenever the sound comes in the form of a sound comes from a telephone, it's transmitted to the hearing impaired individual, which is converted into a typed message. And also closed caption television decoders, as we can see here, we have captions under the, which are enrolled on the television screen when there are news display. And so the prescription of the hearing aid and a cochlear implant or cochlear implant or assistive devices doesn't end the rehabilitation of the hearing impaired. They can also be trained for oral-oral communication, that is, they can be trained for manual communication using Indian Sign Language or American Sign Language or British Sign Language. These are the sign languages which are used in different countries. In India, we use Indian Sign Language. And then total communication, that is, they can also be trained for speech reading and auditory training and speech conservation. And then comes the education of the deaf. So this is the end of the presentation.
సార్ ఓన్లీ ప్రజెంటేషన్ వచ్చిన పెట్టండి కదా, ఫేస్ రాకుండా.
ఓకే జరుగుతుందా సార్ ఇన్స్పెక్షన్?
యా సార్ జరుగుతుందన్నారు కదా, ఇప్పటివరకు అయితే వాళ్ళు రాలేదు ఇంకా, బహుశా 11 o'clock వస్తారు కావచ్చు. నిన్న ఎంతసేపు అయింది సార్? ఇలాగే వచ్చే ప్రయత్నం. So I hope you are able to hear me. So we were talking about the stomach earlier. We were discussing about the neurosurgery part of the general surgery. A couple of questions will be definitely asked from it. So we have talked about it, stock questions and everything. So in the previous class we have discussed about the anatomy of the stomach, and this was to have a better picture while understanding the topic of gastric carcinoma. So just a quick review. This is the on your screen, this is the structural anatomy of the stomach, which you can appreciate it. There is an esophagus which continues into the fundus of the stomach and the body, followed by the pyloric antrum, pylorus, which continues into the duodenum, which is a part of the small intestine. Coming to the arterial supply, the arterial supply, as you can see, is from the celiac trunk. The main the main aspects of it are the left branch and the right branch, the right gastric artery, the proper hepatic artery, the gastroduodenal artery, the splenic artery and the short gastric arteries, where you can appreciate it. And there are this the splenic branches that to the spleen, where this the short gastric artery supplies the greater curvature. All right, so and there is the left gastroepiploic artery, the right gastroepiploic artery, and the superior pancreaticoduodenal arteries. Coming to the venous drainage of the stomach, is again by the short gastric veins, the left gastric veins, the portal, the right and the gastric veins, the superior mesenteric and the right gastroepiploic veins. Okay, which drain into the, can you appreciate it? This is the vena cava, the splenic veins and the left gastroepiploid veins. And the nerve supply, the right vagus vein, which is a mixed vein, the autonomic innervation of the stomach, the right gastric, the right vagus nerve is very important. The right and the left vagus nerve is very important to know its location, especially when you we are performing the truncal vagotomy. Okay, this is the line of the division for selective vagotomy, which is a highly selective vagotomy which yields better results. All right, so and they are the hepatic veins, branch of the left vagus, and the anterior nerve of Retaget, and the pyloric branch of the left vagus. Please understand, please take note on this nervous supply. So coming back, carcinoma stomach, it is more common in Japan, as you have heard, because of this reason the number of surgeries regarding the stomach, pioneers in stomach surgeries, they have been done in Japan. So more common in Japan, and this is more common in males. In the ratio of 2:1, the peak incidence is in the 7th decade of life. The incidence 3% of the total, 6% in the cardia and the fungus, 27% is in the body, and the highest incidence is in the region of the pylorus and the prepyloric region. The risk factors for the carcinoma stomach, the H. pylori infection, the dietary factors, the high salt foods, the smoked meats that contain high levels of nitrate. Then there is the lack of healthy eating habits like fresh fruits and vegetables that are protective against gastric cancer. So this combined with the high intake of the smoked food is indicated in the higher incidence of gastric carcinoma. And there is again the hereditary and genetic factors. There is gene mutation for cell adhesion molecule E-cathetrin, and there is Lee-Fromini syndrome, and there is HNPCC or Lynch syndrome, which is subdivided into one or two. The mutation in tumor suppressor genes P53 and P16, and there is adenomatous polyposis coli gene mutations, and also CMET proto-oncogenes. Oncogenes may be these oncogenes KSAM and CERB2. These oncogenes may be overexpressed in these patients. Okay, so then again there is pernicious anemia, then adenomatous polyps, then the blood group A is more indicated. They are more prone for gastric carcinoma, and there is gastric remnant that is done after gastrectomy and gastrotrichinostomy. So these also inflict higher incidence rates. Okay, and in pernicious anemia there is achlorhydria due to the destruction of chief cells and parietal cells, and this is by an autoimmune reaction because of this. And there is again smoking, there is A gamma globulinemia, then there is chronic benign gastric ulcer, then there is obesity and the meningitis disease, and there is occupational hazards also found in rubber workers, coal workers, and asbestos, lead, talc, and zinc. The number of classifications: there is a pathological classification, there is clinical classification, and there is borders classification. In the clinical classification, important are the Borman classification and the TNM classification. Okay, and in the pathological classification, it is divided into borders, Loren, and WHO classification. These are the classifications. And in the borders classification, it is subdivided into well differentiated, moderately differentiated, poorly differentiated, and the anaplastic. And in the Loren classification, it is divided into two types: intestinal type and the diffuse type. Intestinal type, environmental, and the diffuse, familial. There is gastric atrophy and intestinal metaplasia in the intestinal type, and there is in diffuse type blood group type A. The intestinal type is more common in men than in women, which is vice versa in diffuse type, wherein there is women are it's more incidence women than men. Intestinal type is increasing incidence with age, and diffuse type is found more common in the younger age group. There is gland formation in the intestinal type, whereas it is poorly differentiated. The classic presence of signet ring cells in diffuse type. There is hematogenous spread. There is whereas there is a transmural or lymphatic spread in the diffuse type. Then there is microsatellite instability. There is APC genes mutations. Whereas in the diffuse type, there is decreased E-cathetin. There is P53, P16 inactivation in intestinal type, and there is P53 and P16 inactivation. The same. So, WHO classification is divided into adenocarcinoma, adenosquamous cell carcinoma, the squamous cell carcinoma, undifferentiated carcinoma, and the unclassified carcinoma. The adenocarcinoma is further subdivided into four types, which are papillary, tubular, mucinous, and the signatory. This is very important. The growth pattern. So there is an expanding type which grows en masse. The tumor grows en masse, and the expansion resulting in the formation of discrete tumor nodules with relatively good prognosis. Okay. So, whereas in the infiltrative type, it invades individually. This has a poor prognosis. Whereas in the expanding type, it is relatively has good prognosis, and it is resulting in the formation of discrete tumor nodules, and it grows en masse by expansion, resulting in the formation of tumor nodules. In infiltrative type, it invades individually. So the Bowman classification, very important. This picture will suggest you the type of growth that you can classify depending upon the picture here. You can just appreciate it. When there is the type 1, there is a polypoid or fungating growth. Whereas in the type 2, there is an ulcerating lesion with elevated borders. Can you appreciate this? The type 3 is ulceration with invasion of the wall. This type 1 is a polypoid or fungating growth. Okay. The type 2, there is an ulcer here. And after this ulcer formation, there is invasion in the type 3. The ulceration with invasion of the wall. Can you appreciate this? And in the type 4, there is a diffuse ulceration. Okay, and this is also called as unitis plastica also, which assumes this shape, and type 5 cannot be classified. The TNM staging, the TX primary tumor cannot be assessed, T0, no evidence of primary tumor, carcinoma in situ, intraepithelial tumor without invasion of the lamina propria, T1, tumor invades lamina propria or submucosa. T2, tumor invades muscularis propria or subserosa. T2A invades muscularis propria, and whereas T2B invades subserosa. Okay. Now T3, it penetrates the serosa. The T4, it invades the adjacent structures. Okay. So I'll repeat it. The T1 stage invades lamina propria or submucosa, whereas in the T2 invades muscularis propria or subserosa, T2A invades muscularis propria, and T2B invades subserosa, T3 it penetrates the serosa, and T4 it invades the adjacent structures also. The regional lymph nodes, NX regional lymph nodes cannot be assessed, N0 no regional lymph node metastasis, N1 metastasis in 1 to 2 regional lymph nodes, N2 metastasis in 3 to 6 regional lymph nodes, N3A metastasis in 7 to 15 regional lymph nodes, N3B mets in 16 or more lymph nodes. Okay, so the distant metastasis, the MX, distant metastasis cannot be assessed, M0 no distant metastasis, M1 distant metastasis is present. Okay, so these are the staging. Okay, stage 0 is tumor in situ with N0 M0, stage 1A T1 N0 M0, stage 1B T1, N1, N0, T2A or B with N0, M0. Stage 2, T1, N2, M0, or T2A by or B, N1, M0, and T3, N0, M0. T3A likewise, T2A or B, N2, M0, T3, N1, M0, T4, N0, M0. And T3B, stage 3B is T3, N2, M0. And stage 4, T4, N1 to 3, M0. T1 to 3, N3, M0. Any T, any N, M1. So you have to by heart this TNM staging so that we can stage the tumor, the gastric carcinoma. Then coming back to the mode of spread, it spreads by direct spread, that is the horizontal submucosal spread, vertical spread by invasion across to adjacent structures like pancreas, colon and the liver. Lymphatic spread, it occurs by the permeation and embolization through lymphatics to subpyloric, gastric, pancreatico, duodenal, splenic, celiac, aortic and later to supraclavicular lymph nodes, Virchow's lymph node, also called Virchow's lymph node, the left supraclavicular region. And this is also called as Tosches sign. The blood spread, it occurs to the liver most common, later to lungs and bones also can get involved. And then there is the transperitoneal mode of spread. It can cause peritoneal seedlings leading to ascites and also can cause Krukenberg's tumor in ovary in menstruating age group. Rectal secondaries are also this is remembered as Blumer's shelf. And then there is Sisters Mary Joseph nodules. This is umbilical secondaries are through transperitoneal spread. The presentations, this asymptomatic in early gastric cancer, and then there is non-specific symptoms which is manifested like indigestion, vague epigastric discomfort, constant non-radiating pain which is not related to food intake, and there is specific symptoms depending upon the site of tumor that is causing obstruction, dysphagia, and there is mass. There is metastatic disease presentation like liver secondaries, ascites and the secondaries in the ovary that we just spoke about, which is called Krukenberg's tumor. Yes, rectovesical pouch in the secondaries in the rectovesical pouch, and there is umbilicus, the supraclavicular nodes that we discussed, there is lung and the bone secondaries also. And then there is unusual presentations. Very important to remember, there is this acanthosis nigrans and iris nodes in the axilla. In clinical features, there is loss of appetite and weight, there is early satiety and fatigue, and there is the microcytic hypochromic anemia, and there is a upper abdominal pain, and there is vomiting with features of gastric pyloric obstruction. Then there is mass in the pylorus lies above the umbilicus, nodula are with impaired resonance. This is mobile, this moves with respiration, and the all margins are well defined. Then there is dysphagia. This, along with the jaundice, liver may be palpable, but secondaries which are hard, nodular with amputation. And there is ascites also, then there is Tosches sign positive, which is also called as the Virchow's node. The rectovesical secondaries, the Blumer's shelf on per rectal examination. And then there is Tosches sign positive, migrating thrombophlebitis. The hematemesis can present with melena, present with perforation. Then there is Sister Mary Joseph nodules, and there is cutaneous secondaries, and there is the Krukenberg tumors. Differential diagnosis of gastric carcinoma, the APD, asymptomatic disease, must be ruled out. The pyloric stenosis with gastric alveolar obstruction must also be ruled out. In this gastritis, there can be a pancreatic mass, there can be a transverse colon mass, and there can be advanced fixed stomach mass may mimic peripheral nodal mass. The investigations you must do are the routine blood investigations, then there is liver function test, these are all the routine function tests. Then there is kidney function test, then there are endoscopic procedures, there is flexible fiber optic upper GI endoscopy and the biopsy. There is an EU, endoscopic ultrasonography, and there is CECT of the abdomen. And there is laparoscopy. Diagnostic laparoscopy almost can also be performed. And you can also do a laparoscopic ultrasonography, which is a late recent modality. And there is a rapid urease test and double contrast barium meal that they should be done, and chest x-ray routinely. The fraction test meal, the gastric acid studies, the tumor markers, the CEA and CA199. And there is fecal occult blood test. Now, the flexible upper endoscopy is the diagnostic modality of choice. During endoscopy, multiple biopsy samples must be taken. Approximately 7 or more should be obtained around the ulcer crater to facilitate histological diagnosis. Okay. So, the biopsy of the ulcer when performed, when taken, it can itself may reveal only necrotic debris. When multiple biopsies, like 7 specimens, are taken, the diagnostic accuracy of the procedure approaches 98%. That is why we have to take multiple samples. The addition of direct brush cytology to multiple biopsy specimens may increase the diagnostic accuracy of the study. The size, the location, and the morphology of the tumor should be noted, and other mucosal abnormalities should be carefully evaluated. These are the presentations. There is a cancer in the antrum of the stomach. Okay, and there is an antral cancer bleeding into the cavity. Can you appreciate this? Yes. And there is pre-pyloric carcinoma. Can you see the growth? And there is, these are all the pictures taken on endoscopic ultrasound. Endoscopic procedures, we take pictures, multiple pictures. And while performing endoscopic ultrasonography, you can take multiple specimens also. They can gauge the extent of gastric wall invasion as well as evaluate local node states. It cannot reliably distinguish tumor from fibrosis. Therefore, it is not a good modality for evaluating response to therapy. Yes. Overall, staging accuracy with EES is about 75%. The diagnostic criteria for early or advanced gastric cancer endoscopy are based on Bowman's classification, like we discussed. The radiological diagnosis. This is just for your knowledge sake. This can on the signs of malignant gastric ulcer, the asymmetric or the distorted ulcer crater, the ulcer on the irregular mass, and there is irregular or distorted mucosal folds, and there is loss of rugosity. The mucosal rugae stop far away from the ulcer. Then there is nodularity, mass effect of or loss of distensibility. The margin of the lesion projects outward from the ulcer into the gastric lining, and this is called Kamen's meniscus sign. These are all the pictures suggesting, and can you see it? There is a fundus growth, there is a distal gastric carcinoma. This is proximal gastric carcinoma. There is a nidus plastica, like we discussed under Bowman's classification type 4. Ultrasound abdomen to see liver secondaries and ascites, lymph nodes, ovaries, often effinacy from left supraclavicular lymph node when it is significantly palpable, that is from the virtuous node. CT scan must always be performed in women. A pelvic CT scan or ultrasound is also recommended to look for the Hukenberg's tumor. And CT of the chest may be needed for proximal gastric cancers. CT can readily detect the presence of malignant ascites. The limitations of the CT scan, the major limitations in the evaluation of early gastric primaries and in the detection of small, lesser than 5 mm metastasis in the liver or peripheral surface. These are the limitations. The reported accuracy for CT staging or lymph node might range from 25% to 86%. And then there is laparoscopy. It is recommended as a next step in the evaluation of patients with loco-regional disease. Inspect the peritoneal surfaces and also inspect the liver surface. Identification of advanced disease avoids non-therapeutic laparotomy in 25%. Patients with small volume metastasis in peritoneum or liver have a life expectancy of 3 to 9 months, thus rarely benefit from palliative resection. The cytological analysis, peritoneal fluid or fluid obtained by the peritoneal lavage may reveal the presence of free intraperitoneal gastric cancer cells, identifying patients with otherwise open carcinomatosis. Okay, the patients with positive findings on peritoneal cytology have a poor like prognosis, similar to that of patients with macroscopic stage disease. Then tetracycline fluorescence test. Means under UV light, it shows yellow fluorescence. The CA724 and CA199 and CA125 are other markers. But combined with the PET scan, CT scan is useful to evaluate metabolic, physiologic and functional activity. In this is the flowchart, the treatment part. And you see it, it's followed by the in the last stage, it is by the palliative therapy, which we'll discuss in the stage wise. Okay, these are the treatment options. So there is endoscopic initial stages, endoscopic resections. Okay, and then there is surgical resection once diagnosed, and then there is adjuvant therapy followed by the palliative therapy. Treatment of the localized disease, stage 1, early gastric cancer, like we said. And there is, this include the EMR, endoscopic mucosal resection, the limited surgical resection and the gastric tube. Endoscopic submucosal resection or endoscopic submucosal resection, a subset of patients with endoscopic gastric carcinoma can undergo an R0 resection without lymphadenectomy or gastrectomy. This approach involves a submucosal injection of fluid to elevate the lesion and facilitate the complete mucosal resection under endoscopic guidance. You just do it with the help, just under the lesion, you infiltrate a certain amount of fluid. Now what happens is, if you doing it, you will also create a plane beneath it, and this will facilitate complete mucosal resection under the endoscopic guidance. Then there is emerging variations of EMR techniques, including the cap section and cap versus the ligating device. The related complication rates of EMR are these include like bleeding and the perforations are less comparatively. The tumors invading the submucosa are at increased risk for metastasizing to lymph nodes and are not usually considered candidates for EMR. However, EMR is emerging as a definitive management of selected early gastric carcinomas. Okay. With limited surgical resections, patients with lesions less than 3 cm. Then they can do a gastrotomy with local excision may be done, and this procedure should be performed with full thickness mural excision to allow accurate pathological assessment of T-status. The formal lymph node dissection is not required in these patients. The gastrotomy with lymph node dissection can be considered for patients with early gastric carcinoma who cannot be treated with endoscopic mucosal dissection or limited surgical dissection. However, patients who have intramucosal tumors with poor histological differentiation, and when the tumor size is more than 3 cm, those who have tumor penetration into the submucosa are beyond, and again, there is no consensus on the extent of the lymphadenectomy that should be performed as part of the gastrectomy for early gastric carcinoma. Okay, the dissection of the 11-1 lymph nodes is a reasonable minimal standard at this time. The stage 2 disease and the stage 3 disease. In the stage 2 disease, surgical resection is a cornerstone for treatment with the patients with a localized gastric cancer. Surgical resection can be curative in most patients with early gastric carcinoma. However, stage 2 and 3 disease, surgery is necessary but often not sufficient to cure. The general therapeutic goal is to achieve a micro and a macroscopically complete resection. The extent of gastric resection is determined by the need to obtain a resection margin free of microscopic disease, which is important. A line of resection at least 5 cm from the tumor mass is necessary to ensure a low rate of anastomotic recurrence. The appropriate surgical procedure should be determined by the location of the tumor and the known pattern of the spread. The proximal tumors of the stomach These are resected by total gastrectomy or proximal subtotal gastrectomy. Tumors of the GE junction may require esophagus gastrectomy with cervical or thoracic anastomosis. To avoid postoperative morbidity of reflex esophagitis and impaired gastric emptying associated with proximal subtotal gastrectomy. Total gastrectomy with Roux-en-Y esophagodigenostomy is generally the preferred option. In the mid-body tumors comprise 15-30% of the total tumors, they generally require total gastrectomy to achieve adequate margins, tumor-free margins. Then there are distal tumors can be resected by distal subtotal gastrectomy or total gastrectomy with no difference in overall survival. The risk of this or the sequelae of the total gastrectomy include this early satiety, then there is weight loss and the need for vitamin B12 supplementation. There is nutritional status and the quality of life are superior followed subtotal gastrectomy compared to the total, making it the preferred option when adequate margins can be obtained while maintaining an adequate gastric drainage. Okay, so the laparoscopic gastric resections have been reported for the treatment of gastric cancer. Advantages of the laparoscopic gastric resections: the reduced pain, shorter hospitalization, and improved quality of life. And there is long-term outcome with respect to cancer recurrence rates. The AJCC, the number rather than location of lymph nodes, is prognostic. The extent of dissection is controversial. The nodal involvement indicates poor prognosis. More aggressive approaches to remove them are taken care of. Then there is roulostomy. If you are interested, you can go through this. And there is in Japan, they perform sphenectomy and partial pancreatectomy during D2 resections for primaries whose drainage includes, because of the increased morbidity in the patient, receiving these adjunctive resections. Some surgeons in the West do not typically resect the spleen or pancreas unless involved by the direct extension from the T4 tumor itself. And there is stage 4 disease. Because 20-30% of the gastric cancer patients present with stage 4 disease, there is palliative treatment only. The surgical palliation may include resection with gastrodigenostomy or bypass alone, or in conjunction with percutaneous endoscopic or radiotherapy techniques. Endoscopic laser surgery or endoluminal stent placement as palliative therapy to relieve symptoms and improve the quality of life. Now these things you will be seeing when the top corporate hospitals are advertising, they do the advertisements saying the laser, then there is endoscopic laser surgery or they can stent placements. Okay, so this is again one of the uses of these laser surgeries and the stent placements. While stents have a broader use in the medical practice to increase the patency of lumen, which we'll discuss later. Okay, then these are the pictures what we have discussed. This the 50% gastrectomy can be appreciated, and then there is partial gastrectomy. Okay, then there is subtotal gastrectomy here, and then there is the total gastrectomy here. Okay, and there is the distal pancreatectomy is also done here. And there is the total gastrectomy, hysterectomy, and distal pancreatectomy, which we just discussed. Okay, so this completes your gastric carcinoma. This is sufficient. First of all, you have to concentrate on the etiology, the histological test, the classifications, especially the Bowman's classifications, the investigations you do, and the treatment depending upon the stage of the disease. Okay, so a number of questions will be asked from gastric carcinoma of the stomach. So it is advisable for you guys to be well acquainted with this topic. So So this completes carcinoma of the stomach, and in the next class we will be discussing about the other conditions in the stomach. Thank you so much.
సర్జరీ
అటు సైడ్ ఆపోజిట్ సైడ్ కూర్చోమంటారు
కదా.
ఎవరు అని భయపడ్డాను, పొమ్మని ఇలా చూస్తున్నారు ఏంటని. ఏంటి కెమెరా లేదు అక్కడ?
లేదండి. ఉంది మేడం.